This interview is brought to you by Lynda.com. Very happy to introduce Manveer Hair. He's a gameplay designer at BioWare Montreal. You guys may or may not be working on a game. We're not here to talk about that. You're also a fairly outspoken person in the game industry, and you have a very interesting presentation here at GDC on the advocacy track. I'll let you tell the title yourself.
Sure. The title is Misogyny, Racism, and Homophobia, Where Do Video Games Stand? And so basically to look at the games themselves, not necessarily all the culture around the games, like how people act on Xbox Live, but like what do you do in the games, the content of the games, and how do they fit in with some of the social injustice issues that kind of are really coming up a lot in the industry nowadays and being talked about a lot on blogs and in journalism in general.
I mean, one interesting thing, games, and let's just say it's 30-year history, you know, when it really was able to become a more efficient storytelling, you know, mechanism. It does tend to sort of exist more in a fantasy world where it doesn't interact with real life problems, be it poverty, be it racism, be it any form of injustice. Why do you think, is it just because it's just everyone wants to play it really cautious, or are there other reasons?
I think it's partly the history of games. I think, you know, D&D is a huge influence on video games, and so you have a lot of fantasy constructs that come from that. I do think it's harder to talk about issues straight up, so sometimes you make sci-fi games and you have, you know, different parts of your sci-fi game that kind of acts as an analogy or a metaphor for a bigger problem, right? You have things like the X-Men in the non-video game sense that, you know, kind of speaks to the civil rights movement and now even like the gay rights movement. And so I think it's easier sometimes to talk about those things. But I also think that sometimes we say we're making a fantasy game, but we put realism in it, right? Like we have fantasy genres in all media, and oftentimes women are subservient in those genres, right? And so we take this kind of European Middle Age approach to what realism is and apply it to fantasy, but we always fall back on that, and that's kind of a weird decision. Like, why are we doing that? Is it because we don't know any better, or is it because we consciously want that? And should we be doing that? And so I actually look into the things like that and how our video games are treating them.
I mean, it's interesting. I did not consider that if you sort of look at how we treat the fantasy and if the fantasy is coming from a more medieval mindset, you know, do you think that's informing even sort of the science fiction and the other types of action games that are out there, that it all kind of, it all goes back to Gary Gygax?
I don't think it's straight up that way. I think the general world of culture that we have, and that culture comes from stories we hear, the news we watch, the movies we watch, everything, right? It informs a certain set of biases through stereotypes and things like that. And I think they get reinforced and they just become ingrained in the culture. And so, you know, when you go back and you're like, well, I want to make a family in my game, if I ask you to think about, like, what would a family, you know, a mother, a father, and a son be in a game, you're probably in picture in your head as like a white family, frankly. It is the picture most of our heads, even me as a racial minority, because that's what the culture's kind of told us is the default. And so I think that's what's influencing these decisions the most, but I think we're part of culture. So if we're redoing that in our games, then we're just reinforcing this loop. And at the very least, let's like clean our house and like let's see how we can fix and do better let's at least be cognizant of it so we want to make those decisions, that we are consciously making those decisions and we're not just falling back on them because it's the default way to go.
I mean, now, one of the interesting things about video games, I mean, I think there's a certain more pernicious problem with this in something like film, television, you know, where it's a static medium.
Right.
You know, you can't change it. But here we actually have player agency, and I would say, you know, definitely in a BioWare game and many other games out there where you can make your own character, there seem to be some efforts to let the player create some type of representation of the world as they see it.
Absolutely.
Or how they see them themselves.
Absolutely. There's a lot of great games that let you create your own character. I know when I get to create a character, I usually make a brown guy, sometimes a black guy, usually never a white guy, because that's not how I see myself. And it's about identity, right? Like you kind of identify with stuff in the media and you look out for things that reflect your identity. And so for me, it's like, that's what I want to do all the time. And that's one way to go about it. But we also have a lot of authored characters in their games, right? Like we have the Nathan Drakes and like, you know, the Booker DeWitts. And we have a lot of those guys that look and kind of act the same. They're the kind of everyman hero. But they usually all fall down the same kind of heterosexual white male look. And that, I want to see more authored characters as well that take on LGBTQ characteristics, or, you know, are women. You know, the major game we have of women is like basically Lara Croft in the big AAA games. You know, we had things like Gone Home where you got to play as a female character, and there was a large like gay storyline in that game. So there's a lot of, you're starting to see it come in, and I think people are really responding well to those games. I think a lot of us are probably tired of playing the same thing, And so we're getting some new experiences out of it, but we're also reflecting a more fair, less negative society by doing it. And I think that's kind of important.
Well, obviously, you know, I could see that on the creative side of the industry, you know, people in your position, right. You know, who are on the development side, I could see them wanting to sort of move in that direction. But I think I was just reading something quite recently that, you know, from a marketing, from a business standpoint, the idea of having an openly gay character as your lead, or even having a woman on the box, as in the case of Last of Us,
right.
That, you know, you have the people that are holding the money just don't seem to want to go that way.
Yeah, absolutely.
I don't know what the step is going to have to be to create that level of confidence.
Yeah, it's kind of this like, it's a catch 22, right? So we haven't made enough games to prove that they can do well, but because we haven't done it, we go, well, games don't do so well. Ben Kuchera, who you used to run the Penny Arcade Report, did this article in 2012 and looked at this and was talking to some of the guys at EEDAR, which is like a video game research firm, and basically found that male games, like male protagonists, were selling better by 25%, I think was the number. But if you actually looked at the marketing spends and the budget spends, the games starring women weren't getting the support. So if we're not getting them on equal level ground, we can't really cherry pick that data and go, well, yes, that works, or yes, it doesn't. So I think we got to start pushing, you know, all phases of the industry, you know, whether it's marketing, PR, the executives, the developers themselves. Like, we all have a part in this, and we should start thinking about that, and we should make the game we want to make. Like, nobody should have to be forced to, like, you know, diversify the game if they don't want to. But if you look at the trend a lot across the industry, we kind of stink at it. And I think being cognizant, we can do a better job across the board.
I mean, I think a point that I find quite interesting, you know, last year, you know, there's been a lot of this discussion actually in the past year,
yeah.
You know, but we have a game like Bioshock Infinite,
yeah.
Which while you are playing a white male character as the lead, it's actually quite relevant to the plot in this world of racism.
Sure.
And you have Daisy Fitzsimmons, who is probably one of the few African-American female characters I can think of in a game,
yeah.
Other than actually in the Assassin's Creed DLC. In that case, and then some of the flack that Rockstar got for the female characters in Grand Theft Auto, it seems that if you start to move into that new territory, it's so novel that suddenly as the creator, you're carrying a very heavy burden. You are now, you know, having to deal with a level of representation.
Right.
And you're going to have a lot of scrutiny. I could see, even in the best of intentions, people wanting to shy away from it because it's going to carry a lot more than just kind of helping out the game.
Right. And I've absolutely heard people in the industry say that kind of thing. Like, I worry that if I do that, I'm going to get a lot more flack if I do it wrong. And, like, developers have... They're not as humble as you might think when you, like at least over drinks and closed doors. A lot of them are very confident, like, I'm really good at writing, or I'm really good at design, or whatever their specialty may be. And I know the people in this industry are extremely smart. So I know if we bother spending some time researching and, like, vetting our writing and our characters and our thoughts with other people in the industry, that everyone is capable of making fair representation. They don't have problems. Like, if I need to write a female character, I'm not a writer, but if I was a writer and I need to write a female character, frankly, I would probably run my lines or the plot by a number of women writers that I know and respect. So to be like, well, what am I assuming that's a bad assumption? What stereotypes am I falling upon to get another point of view? And I don't think that's that hard to do. We do that all the time already with our content. Like, I think there's a fear there, but I think it's a fear that we are creative and strong and intelligent enough to get kind of past, and some games are gonna mess up. Frankly, some games will mess up, and collectively, we should hopefully learn from those mistakes and get better.
I mean, is this also indicative, and this gets talked about so much, that look, the video game industry is predominantly male, predominantly
yeah.
white, and that lack of diversity in employment is really what's also helping reinforce kind of the same white
yeah.
male characters over and over.
Yeah,
again.
Even like, frankly, most people are middle class, and even like you see a lot of the same socioeconomic backgrounds in games and things coming from a certain perspective. Like, have you played a game where you're male and white but poor in a game? There's not as many of those, like rags to riches stories, outside of a handful of sim games and some other stuff. Yes, I personally definitely think that influences things greatly, because you write things and you create things and you design things you know and you're comfortable with, and all of that is determined by your class, your race, your gender, your sexual orientation, and a whole host, your age, all those things, right? And so we need to get more people in the industry, but it's, again, like, this is a chicken and egg problem. Like, well, we need to get more people in the industry, but like, how do I get in the industry if I don't even know that's a viable option, or if I don't see myself drawn towards video games because, and maybe I'm not seeing myself drawn towards video games because I'm pushed away by the representation levels in games. Like I've talked to people before, you know, in like in the African American community, I had a friend of mine, and like he's like, "Wait, you make video games? You can do that?" I was like, "Yes," but I realized, oh, we're from different economic backgrounds, and no one told you. I grew up with computers around me. My dad's a software engineer. I thought I could always do that. He never realized that that was a viable way to go in life.
No, I think it's a really interesting point because I know just from my years covering games and just meeting fans, it's a very, very diverse audience.
Yeah, absolutely.
That plays video games, but I think that sort of opportunities are not being presented to all the people who play games, you know, to learn and understand what the processes are to make them and make that a viable employment.
Yeah, and in fact, I believe Latino Americans are the fastest growing segment of game buyers. They buy more games than anybody other demographic, yet you don't see them represent. They're highly underrepresented in games.
And if it is, it tends to be, once again, very, almost too novel.
Yes, it becomes very, falls back on a lot of the tropes, and usually, unfortunately, they're very negative, right?
So you have one exception, now that I think about it, Gears of War.
Sure.
And I do know that that game is insanely popular in Mexico
right.
because it just has a heroic image of what would appear to be, even though it's a fantasy world,
right.
a Latino character.
Sure, absolutely. And you can see people attached to that those sorts of things. Again, they want to see themselves in a game often. I think a lot of us want that. And when there's so few representations, frankly, you'll grasp onto anything you can. Like, I actually can't remember. My parents are from India. I don't remember the last Indian character in a game that wasn't like a horrible person or a terrorist, frankly. And that's kind of upsetting. I have to make that character, you know, when I'm playing, you know, one of those create your own character types of games instead.
You talked a little bit about the indie scene, and I was also just thinking of a game like Papers, Please, which I think might be one of the most effective ways of showing socioeconomic trouble.
Yes. and I talk about Papers, Please in my talk, actually.
It really kind of highlights what... I'm nicer to people at the low level of a bureaucracy.
Right.
as a result of that game. But how essential, and is it? I'm almost wondering if it's only going to start happening in the indie scene. It has to happen there before it can ever filter up to the big budget AAA games.
I think it can work from both ends, but I do see probably more and faster progress in the indie scene because they don't have to answer to people, so they have less people to convince. And the more people you have to convince, it's a lot harder because you have to make the logical argument and get them on your side, and then they have to go one step up to their boss, and that has to keep going up. But I don't think it's impossible. But Papers, Please is a great example of the things that you can absolutely do. And what Papers, Please does is it doesn't just represent it, right? It creates game mechanics around like the socioeconomic thing of being a kind of an immigrant or working at the border of a quasi-Eastern Bloc country. And actually, that's even more interesting to me because what video games do as well is interaction. So if we only handle the things in the narrative layer, we're just doing what movies and books and everything else can do. But when we start building mechanics that codify like ethnocentrism and nationalism, which is what Papers, Please does, you start to actually understand that game better, understand the problems, and actually like, oh, I understand how these systems were built, and that system makes me do possibly racist or ethnocentric things. And that's how I felt playing the game, and it was kind of eye-opening and powerful. And actually, that was my favorite game of last year.
I mean,
personally.
I think at the end of the day, that's one of the things I think we're really not taking advantage of in games, because of the interactivity, because you really have to make assumptions and read things.
Yep.
There is so much more opportunity to explore, if not societal ills, then kind of wake us up to sort of certain preconceptions.
Absolutely.
I mean, I want to believe we're going to do this. I'm looking to you to kind of make a case to me that there really is an opportunity out there to see games move into that territory.
Yeah, I mean, I think you're starting to see it, like you said, in the indie scene. You're seeing the representation portion definitely being included. There's a lot of, you know, queer and indie devs who are making games that speak to their causes and what they believe in or how their lives have been. And those have been amazingly successful, at least critically, in terms of people really understanding the content. And I think Papers, Please is a great example of that next order, right? That step of building dynamics and mechanics into your game that have the meaning, because that's how our games are meaning. And you know, I know a lot of people who love those things, and I think they're going to start emulating them more and more, right? You could see how, you know, people love David Simon's The Wire series. It's become a very culturally popular cult classic thing. And you could see how someone could build a game about working on the corner and the problems that you're going to run into if you wanted to try to leave the corner and the systems that are in place. And it would be a lot more effective to me at convincing someone of the problems of of the police system, of the war on drugs, of all that stuff, by working that corner, then watching The Wire, which I think is highly effective at like making an interesting case for that.
Yeah, it's just fascinating. I just thought that obviously a lot of the logic of the drug dealing that, that happened in that movie, that you can see the systems that are
exactly
immediately applicable inside of a
right.
game. That's fascinating. I think my final question is, and because you know when. With games, I think a lot of people, sometimes like, please don't, you know, bring your politics into the game.
Sure.
You know, this comes up a lot, but I'm getting the sense from you, and I know I feel this too, that this is not shaming the games that currently
no.
exist. This is trying to sort of broaden what games can do
Absolutely.
And should do. It's not at the expense of one for the other.
Absolutely. I think it's just we have a lot of games out there that are the same, and I would like to see a bigger diversification in games in general. So if the best thing for your game is to make a white heterosexual male character who has the Indiana Jones look, like, I think you should be able to do that, and no one should, like, you know, kind of bust your chops.
You haven't done wrong.
Yeah. No, I don't think you've done wrong. But I think it's when, like I said before, it's that pattern that emerges that we all do that, and that not enough of us are trying other things. What I'd like to get to is a point where, as an industry, we're making such a diverse group of games that everyone has different things that they can find that speak to them and fit them. And they'll be of different budget, frankly. Some things will be more mass market, some things will be in the middle, some things will be tiny, like, you know. And that's okay, we should have that diverse swath. We'll become a better, stronger, more creative industry, I think, as a result of that.
No, and it's something that, as you talk about it, just makes me excited. Whatever
yeah.
you can do to help usher this
yeah,
along,
you
please
know.
Do. I'll do what I can on
thank,
my end.
Thank you so much
so
for having me.
Here. One thing to really consider is that it's not just about programming to make it in the game industry. There's a wide breadth of skills that are applicable, and you can learn some of those by checking out lynda.com. They're an online learning company with more than 77,000 video tutorials that teach software, creative, and business skills. You can learn anytime, anywhere, and at your own pace with courses in web design, 3D and animation, design, programming, and many more, with new courses being added every week. Membership starts at only $25 per month, but you can try lynda.com free for 7 days, and you're supporting Rev3 Games, all by signing up at lynda.com/Rev3 Games.